The following program was provided by an independent producer solely responsible for its content. The opinions expressed do not necessarily represent the views of this station, its staff, board of directors, or underwriters.
Hello and welcome to My Studio, a program that explores the artistic soul by sharing the creative process, vision, determination, and personal desire to create art. I'm your host, Ginny Barrett. In this episode, we visit the 62nd Annual Greeley Park Art Show, sponsored by the Nashua Area Artists Association. The show features artists from the greater Nashua area, as well as local student talent. Please join me as we visit many of the various artists and discuss their work, how they make it happen, and why they do it. Our first artist is Lauren Alana, a distinguished jeweler. Let's visit with her and see her work.
Good morning. How are you, Lauren?
Good. How are you?
Good. We come back to see you and your artwork to talk to you about how you make your glass pieces.
Yep.
Could you explain how you do that process?
I'll do that. It starts off with pieces of glass. So every color and every texture is a different piece of glass. And what I do is I layer it. I start with a base color, blue, pink, whatever. Layer the glass, put a clear piece of glass on top of that, and then it goes in the kiln, and it heats up to 1450 degrees, gets red hot, fuses together. And then when it comes out of the kiln, I have like a tile, and I cut out the shapes with a wet saw and a grinder with diamond blades. And then it goes back in the kiln for another 6-7 hours to smooth out the edges. And then I cut a groove in it and wrap it with sterling silver wire.
Wow. Like something like this?
Mm-hmm.
Do you do a whole slab of glass and then like, cut it into pieces?
Yeah, I do. Like it's like a tile, usually like 4x4 or 5x5, although it could be any size.
And then the complementary beadwork as well?
Yes.
Very nice.
What I usually do is take the dichroic glass right with me if I go to get the beads so I can match it up.
Oh, makes sense. So much work for beautiful, beautiful work. How did you master that technique? How long did that take?
Oh, I've been doing it probably close to 10 years now.
10 years.
I've been doing the dichroic, yeah.
And so everyone in your family has a beautiful necklace. The yep. Family is your best customer.
They are, definitely are.
So how many shows do you do in a year?
Probably about 20, between, you know, art shows, craft fairs, farmers markets.
Yeah. And what type of jewelry do you specialize in? We talked about the glass, but I see some copper.
Yeah, I'm just getting into a little bit of metalsmithing. And I also do the chainmail, which is an ancient art. That's how they used to make the knight's armor.
Could you show us that?
So, yeah,
that's interesting.
So I open and close all the rings and weave them together. Like this particular pair has like 8 or 9 different size rings.
Wow.
So by the time I get to the end, it's both mentally and physically challenging.
Very intricate. Do you use old Celtic knot designs or?
There's all different patterns, like you can see in here, how all the different patterns that they are and the different size rings that you use. Some are flat and square, some are bigger and smaller, so it gives you a different look for, even though it's the same weave, but it gives you a different look. Like this is the same, these three are the same weave. But they look really different because some are small, some are square, some are big.
Where do you show your art? Do you use art shows to sell your work, or do you also have boutique jewelry stores where you sell this?
Maison de la Art down on East Pearl, and of course the Nashua Area Artists Association Art Hub Gallery.
The gallery at 30 Temple Street. Very good. Very good. Could we just take a look at some of your pieces? Do you have a website?
Yep. It's www.laurenelenajewelry.com.
Very good. Thank you very much for letting us stop in and talk to you today, Lauren. Okay, we are visiting the studio booth of Lisa Papastefanou.
Papastefanou.
Lisa, could you tell me, you're using acrylic here in the background?
I am. I use acrylic for pretty much all of my work. I do some watercolor and some wood burning, but the majority of my work is acrylic.
So you do like a wash with some of the acrylics first, you do that, and then are you inspired on what you want to put on there?
Sometimes I choose the color that I feel like working with. Sometimes I'll know a theme, like this I knew I wanted to do water. I hadn't decided on doing a whale yet. But a lot of times what will happen is, even if I have something set in my head to paint, I'll do a background, and then the background changes what I end up doing. See the background, and it just kind of...
It speaks to you?
Yeah, it kind of says, I'm going to be this, and not what you were originally thinking. So that's pretty much it.
I like the detail in your animals. It kind of is reminiscent of some of the... like Eskimo or some of the Indian kind of totems.
I'm glad you
picked
up on that.
Yeah. On there.
I try to actually take different tribal or image styles from all over the world. I'll look at, you know, Scandinavian, Indian, African types of tribal or design work, and then I take those different pieces and I mix and I match to suit what form I'm trying to create on the animals or whatever it is that I'm painting.
Very good. It gives a kind of a spiritual kind of...
Sort of. I'm bringing the world together all in one picture.
Well, you know, that's what artists do. They bring the world together. Yeah. Can you explain some of the woodwork that you're doing and how you managed to do that?
I have basically your... I'll take a cedar plank. It's actually decking boards. But I cut them the size that I want them, and then I use the cedar dual purpose. I'm a practical person, so
yeah.
I leave the back exposed for, helps keep the vermins out of the house while you're looking at something pretty, but I will wood burn the image that I want. I don't draw anything out first. I just go straight, any of my work, it's all straight freehand.
Very impressive.
And then I'll touch in some color afterwards with a little bit of watercolors.
I see.
And then I just urethane it in a water-based, non-toxic on the face to protect it, so you can put it, you could even put it on your porch or something like that.
I see a lot of nature scenes that you put on the wood.
I do a lot of nature scenes on the woods. I do a lot of trees. We do a lot of different kinds of animals. I actually just sold a drum set yesterday. So I don't just stick to the nature scenes, but that tends to be what people enjoy. And I really create for other people. Like I might see somebody walking by or something like that. I'm like, well, I bet they'd like this. And sometimes that will actually inspire what I do. More than my head has got everything in it, and I'm kind of eclectic. So I kind of, a lot of the animals were actually inspired by my son to paint.
And how does your son inspire you for animals?
He loves them.
He
loves animals. So I basically, I one day I was sitting, oh, Vincent, what should I paint? I think he was 2 at the time. Paint an alligator, mama, you know, whatever. And that's the way, you know, it forces you to be creative, forces you to kind of.
Yeah, yeah.
All right, how do I want to paint an alligator? You know, whatever. And so, and then sometimes I just want to paint certain things, and it's of my own choice.
Do you do commission work?
I do a lot of commission work, actually.
Yeah.
My wood burning is especially, most of my scenery paintings that I do are commission-based. They usually don't last long when I put them in. And I'm working on an 8-foot-long mural.
Wow.
On canvas, but yeah. it's a triptych, but I'm calling it a mural because it's 8 feet wide. So
that would be 3 different canvases making
correct.
Up one painting.
Correct. Yeah, yep.
Very good.
Yeah.
And do you also sell online? Do you have a web presence?
I have a Facebook site that is my website at the moment. I'm trying to expand on that. I am I'm a bit illiterate when it comes to technology, I will not lie.
It's a challenge.
And I don't get along so well, but I'm trying to work on that. So.
Very good. So if people wanted to get in touch with you, how would they do that?
Facebook is a good way. Eccentrics Art Gallery on Facebook, or I put my phone number right on my business card because it's an easy enough way to get a hold of me. But a lot of people do it through Facebook, and I do try to keep it updated and post new pictures of different things, and a lot of people respond on that.
So Facebook page, repeat the name if you would.
It's Eccentrics, but it's Xntrix Art Gallery.
Eccentrics Art Gallery.
Yep.
Wonderful.
Yeah.
Wonderful. Thanks for speaking with us today.
Oh, you're most welcome. It was a pleasure.
Interrupt your work. No, maybe we might come back and take a look and see the finished piece.
All right. Sounds good.
Thank you, Lisa.
Take care.
Hi, we're in the booth of Beverly Melle, and Beverly, you do specifically acrylics?
No, actually I work with oil and acrylic, and I'm experiment with watercolor, but mostly oil.
Oh, very, very good. So what's the challenge between oil and acrylic for you?
Acrylic dries too fast for me, but I understand there are a lot of mediums you can add to it so that it doesn't, but I have such a supply of oils that I use oil because it takes a lot longer to dry, so I can rework it
You rework it.
Yeah.
Excellent. Excellent. What's, you said on your card here, and we saw the picture of your lovely granddaughter. Is she your muse?
My granddaughters. Actually, I love doing children's portraits, and will do commissions of children's portraits. It gives me great pleasure, and I'm, you know, the person on the beach sketching out the little kids, and there'll be some pictures here and there, probably on the other side. At the park, if I see somebody on a swing, something like that. I just love capturing that joy and delight that kids often.
Oh, yeah. It's hard to capture that because of fleeting moments.
Yes, yes.
What's with the trucks?
What's with the trucks? They have so much character. I guess I really like if I can find a truck that's as rusted out as that. And it's called retired. I'm retired. So I could identify with a rusted old truck with no use anymore. But I just like old things.
Do you paint plein air or do you take pictures and bring them back to your studio?
I try to paint. If in this case I was out there, this is actually the ocean, but I put a farm there because it didn't make sense that the ocean would be there. Maybe he was a fisherman, who knows?
Artistic license.
That's right. And so most of these were from a trip to Maine, right here. Some of the others were, you know, wherever I am, and I'll try to do a sketch. And I'll take pictures too, and I'll try to paint there, and then finish it at home if I need to.
Very good.
I don't want to follow a photograph. I want to put things where I want to.
Now when you do commission work for portraits, they send you photos.
Right.
That's when you work from the photos.
Either take photos myself or have them send me photos, but I like to sit with the child a little bit so I get to know their personality and put that in there too. And somehow you need to do that. Although my last commission, the one I'm working on now, is a photo from 1956 that somebody gave me of their siblings, and they wanted me
to do it. It's a black
and white photo, so I have free reign with the color of the wallpaper, the color of the dresses and the suits and whatever. It looked like an Easter picture. Another one I did, a woman's daughters had grown up and moved to Europe, and she wanted to capture in an oil painting when they were 13 and 17. So she just gave me several photos, and I worked from those. And she was delighted because one little girl, the 17-year-old, was very fashionable, Breck girl looking, and the other one was very outdoorsy. And so
Nice. Yeah. So you get their personality in there too.
Yeah. So you need to have more than one photo where they're posing.
Yeah. Very good. And if somebody wanted to reach you, how would they get in touch with you, or if they want to see more of your work, Beverly?
Well, you can go on a website called Venture Companion and venturecompanion.com and put my name in, and there'll be artwork there. carbonmade.bevmelle.carbonmade.com or .org. I have some photos there. Picasa, I have some portfolio works there too. That would probably be more landscape. These are okay. from a while back. But, yeah, you can find me there. And I live in Amherst, New Hampshire, and it's beverlymelle@gmail.com. And if anybody's interested in capturing whatever, I've got a 4th of July truck from their parade. you know, a little bit of everything. I just paint for pleasure.
Wonderful, basically. Wonderful. Well, thank you for spending time with us.
Thank
I appreciate
you.
That.
Thanks very much.
Good luck with the show.
Okay, thank you.
We're here this morning with Heather Crowley. Heather does watercolor and acrylic. And basically, I love the mandalas that you have here.
Thank
when
you.
Did you start doing those and move from the rectangular traditional?
I started doing mandalas in 2010, so about 5 years ago. And I took a art retreat with a visionary artist that year. And when I came back from the retreat, I did my first one, and I was kind of hooked.
So it means something spiritual to you.
It does, yeah. It definitely does. I think everything kind of moves in circles. So, and there's a very different energy when I'm painting the mandalas versus sort of the more traditional square or rectangular paintings. And then I turn the painting as I'm painting it, and it's just, it's wonderful. Creating it is just, it's a lot of fun.
Right. So we moved from last year, the painting beside you was a ribbon winner.
Yes.
And in the newsletter, so an award-winning artist. could you show us and explain one of your mandalas?
Yeah. Sure.
I like the one with is this a water lily?
It is, yes. And a dragonfly. And so this is called Elemental Journey, and it came out of my yoga practice. My teacher does five element yoga, and this actually came to me during one of the yoga classes.
Wow.
I saw it, and then I wanted to paint it. And so it's got fire at the bottom, sort of like the core of the earth has that fire magma center. And then we go up into the dirt, which is earth, and then this is water. And the roots of the lotus are kind of making the journey through the elements, through the dirt and up through the water, and then coming up into the air. And then space is the fifth element that kind of holds the whole thing together. And there's a dragonfly nymph that's kind of traveling with the lotus up out of the water. And this is sort of the little thing that they leave behind when they emerge from their nymph form. And then that's the dragonfly that's kind of up in the air.
Fascinating.
Yeah.
Fascinating.
Yeah.
You got a very good control of whites.
Yeah.
That's very difficult to do, to get the white that
right.
with all the colors in it
yeah.
and not just do white.
Yeah.
Great definition.
Thank you.
I love the journey and the story of the painting also.
Yeah. Thank you.
I see you have some smaller pieces here.
I do.
How are you inspired to do some of these that we see the autumn leaves?
Nature. I'm very drawn to the natural world and the beauty in the natural world and kind of trying to want to capture that and share it with other people.
So. Are these all watercolor?
They are. All of them are watercolors. The larger ones are limited edition prints, G-clay prints, and all of the small mini mandalas are original watercolors.
How do you get the vibrancy on the reds, especially when watercolor is basically so transparent?
It is, and I do a lot of layering, a lot of washes, and that's how I get it more opaque. Some people use gouache to get that opaque.
Yeah.
I've tried gouache, and I'm not terribly fond of it because it doesn't have the transparency that the watercolors do. I think the watercolors are a little bit more malleable, and you can get them to be more opaque looking. You just got to layer a lot. So I've got a lot of layers in there.
Okay, just going to let that motorcycle go by. The handprint.
Yeah.
This is on your card. Also, I saw that you had a card. Do you teach classes?
I don't teach classes. I've had people ask me if I teach classes, but I don't do that. I feel like I've got so much that I want to do with my own art that I don't really have enough time to take that on right now.
So you're just not finished with your inspiration?
No, not at all. I've got so many paintings lined up in my head that I want to do. Just got to find the time to do them, so.
Can we talk about this one
sure.
right in between us?
Sure. This is, I think, the second big mandala that I did.
It's it, yeah.
And it's got a lot of Eastern symbolism in it, and it's got the four elements in it again. I'm really drawn to the four elements. So it's got animals with the different elements, so dragon with fire, eagle with air, salmon with water. This is the wolf with the earth. And then it's also got a lot of Buddhist and Eastern philosophy symbols in it. This is a Tibetan endless knot. This is the yin-yang, my interpretation of it. I do it sort of as a night-day, but it's a non-dual symbol in Eastern philosophy. This is the symbol for Om, which is Hindu or yoga philosophy, meditation aid. And this is the Tree of Life, which some people think is more Celtic or Christianity, but I kind of think the Tree of Life is kind of universal to all spiritual traditions.
Yeah.
So, and then it's got a metta blessing in it, which is a loving kindness blessing, which is a Buddhist meditation blessing.
And it says, may all beings be happy.
Yeah, may all beings be healthy. May all beings be safe, and may all beings find peace.
Wonderful.
Thank you.
Wonderful. It would be a definite wonderful addition to anyone's home.
Thank you. Thanks.
Is there anything you'd want to tell our viewers?
I have a studio in East Kingston.
Wonderful.
A round studio, as a matter of
fact. A round studio, perfect for your
men. Goes with my mandalas. And if people want to come and visit, I'd love to have them come visit.
Oh, very good. Yeah. So how would they reach you on internet? Or
I have a Facebook page, and I also have a website, Willow Road Watercolors.
Willow Road Watercolors.
Yeah.
Very good.
Yeah.
Well, thank you so
thank
much,
you
Heather,
much.
for letting us visit with you.
It was wonderful talking to you.
Same here. Hey, we're visiting the booth of Harriet Winchester, oil painter and pastel artist. You said you worked in pastel before going into oil?
I did. I worked with the pastel for a good 22 years or so. And then I found that the pastel dust, I just couldn't stand it anymore, both from the dust and in the air, which no matter what you do, it gets in the air, and from the feel of it. And so I switched to oil. This old one is pastel. And then I think the first one I did when I switched to oil was this. Partly picked it for its colors.
Beautiful.
And the harmony of the colors. And then this was probably the next one I did. This is some lace that was in my sister's family, or her husband's family. And it's Swedish. It's called Hardanger work. And it's partly pierced, cut out, and then embroidered. And so, of course, to paint lace, you have to paint each hole.
Little square.
Yes, and paint and shadow, because there's a little shadow on the raised edges of the embroidery, and also
very
shadows
good.
On the edges of the lace to give that three-dimensional appearance.
It would be easy, very easy to overlook that. That's a very good detail, a very good eye for detail.
I've always loved the detail. And then this, no lace, but this one's actually pastel too, and it's on a sanded paper that's an artist grade special paper. But the sandpapery finish is rough enough that I was able to do almost all of the shading on the white plate and then add the blue pattern, because the sandpapery, it was a rough enough texture, so it would still take more pastel. And I didn't have to go around every single bit of it. And then another oil with a little bit of lace.
Those grapes look very refreshing. Really good.
Well, actually, there's a refrigerator right behind there.
we told that
to a little kid once, and he went and checked.
He went and checked. He looked. That's so funny. And when you use the pastel, do you do a spray a fixative on it?
I do not.
Between
pastel painting out of 20, I might spray while I'm working on it. But if you spray a pastel at the end of it when you're finished, it will darken the colors mostly, or change them. As far as I can remember, every color darkens. There might be some that just get lighter. One of the things is your highlights will really
lose them.
Fade back. So just glass. This has museum glass on it.
Okay.
So you can't really see that there's glass there. That one, you can see the reflections in.
When you mat, using regular glass, you have to keep the mat out from,
yes,
keep the glass,
yes,
out from the,
yes,
image, so
yeah,
you don't smear
this
it.
This has the mat, and it's got spacers under the mat, just actually just another piece of mat board. So the total thickness is, it's less than a quarter inch. This has a spacer in it, a clear acrylic spacer.
Okay.
It's about, it's probably about 3/16, probably not a whole quarter inch. So that's spaced off the glass too.
It's very interesting because over time, or if pastel gets jostled, the dust or the actual pastel can loosen up and show a dusty edge at the bottom of your frame.
Yeah, sometimes you'll show dust on the edge of the mat. But there's especially a problem doing the festivals and fairs, and they get carried around all the time, and it's real hard. One time though, I was doing an indoor show in a mall, so the floor was hard.
Okay.
So I knocked a pastel over right on its face. I picked it up and I said, oh no, there's pastel all over the glass. But I took it home, took it apart, cleaned the glass, put it back together, and you would never know. It was kind of amazing. By the time you finish the pastel painting, you've got a good layer of pastel on there. And they're durable. They're like any other artwork, if they're protected from sunlight and dampness.
Yeah, yeah.
They'll last for hundreds of years.
So you're not concerned about today's humidity?
I would be if this was in the sun.
Yeah.
If you have paintings under glass that are in the sun and the painting is cool.
Yes.
And the glass is cool, and the painting warms up, and then you get condensation on the glass.
In between.
And that can be a problem because you can damage the mat.
And all that work.
Yeah, so you try to keep your paintings under glass out of the sun.
Good to know. Well, thank you. Is there anything you want to let our viewers know? Maybe how to get in touch with you?
I have a studio in my house in Nashua. I'm in the telephone book, the old-fashioned way, as Harriet Winchester. And I have an email. My email is hwk@intrel.com. It's I-N-T-E-R-E-L. Too many E's. I-N-T-R-E-L.com.
And they could arrange commission work or
I
see some of your
work?
I
rarely do commissions, but they could find out where I was showing.
Okay, so you sell basically through shows?
Most of the time. I've done much better over the last 25 years through shows than galleries, although occasionally I've sold through galleries.
Okay. Thank you so much for letting us visit you, Harriet.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you. Okay, we're visiting with Liz Winchester-Larson.
Mm-hmm.
And Liz does pencil, oil pastel, and block prints. Something, a new technique that we haven't seen at this show. Liz is going to explain to us how she does her linoleum blocks and some of her etchings.
Monotypes.
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 All right.
Okay. Well, we'll start with one of the monotypes. This one is what I call a line drawing monotype. The water-based ink is rolled with a tool called a brayer on a plexiglass palette through water-based block printing ink. And then the paper, which I use fine art Japanese printmaking papers. This paper is called Cheery. It's made with kozo and mulberry fibers and has little inclusions. It's all speckly. Little inclusions of bark.
It definitely adds a lot of interest to the image.
Right. Then what I do is I lay the paper down on the surface of the ink and with a pencil draw on the back side, that transfers the ink drawing to the paper, and then I very carefully lift the paper off the palette, that's the printmaking surface, and then that gets hung, the papers get hung up to dry. And when I'm doing these, I'm working in a series, because you just don't squeeze out one ink and do one print.
Understood.
You then scrape that ink off the palette, re-roll that, you draw again, but they're not ever the same. I might draw, you know, a different flower shape. There's not a specific image that you repeat,
okay,
like
so
you would with
no
a
two are alike.
No two are quite alike.
Can you tell us of the process on this particular piece here? This is also a monotype and different layers, plus you added color and the white spattering to give it a snowflake effect.
Yeah, it's a similar process of doing a drawing on the ink.
Uh-huh.
After this print is dry, I added the color that's in here with soft pastels. And after I had put that down, I took the white of this printmaking ink and I thinned it a little bit with a little bit more water. I used a stiff bristle brush about the size of a toothbrush, but stiffer bristles, and I dipped it in that puddle of ink, and then with a you can use the other end of a brush.
A handle from a brush.
Yeah, yep. Handle from a brush.
And you just scrape it?
Yeah, you draw that over and you get snow spatter everywhere.
Snow spatter everywhere.
Snow spatter everywhere. And so you have to build sort of like a little paint booth. So they don't get, I've done it without it. I get spatter over the kitchen cabinets and over the cat and everything else like that.
You also do linoleum block.
Right? All right. Because there are a lot of people that aren't as familiar with linoleum blocks, I bring a sample of one of my plates. The block is also called a plate. And this is a linoleum block that I have cut. This is a cutter that you cut the linoleum block with. I've had these for years and they're wood handles. And then when you're cutting away, you cut away from the surface all the areas that will not be printed. This one is a very fine V groove. And this process, and I have other knives and cutters that work to cut away the surface of the linoleum. It's a very interesting medium for doing artwork. If you want a little history about linoleum, it was invented in England as a flooring material, but artists in the early 20th century, like Picasso and Matisse, discovered that you could use it as a printmaking material. And they would create some of their prints using the linoleum material. Because it does not have a grain like a wood block, it's soft and easier to cut. Some people run theirs through a press, but you can also do a linoleum block without needing all that equipment. I generally work on my kitchen table.
Oh, easy to do at home.
Yeah, easy to do in your home studio.
So you have to work in the reverse. When you're cutting the linoleum block,
right?
We see the linoleum block and then we see the finished print. We can see how...
If you can see this, if I can
Don't
hold
cut yourself.
Nope. You can see that and I'll hold them up together. It's a process where you have to think backwards, or you can simplify it. Generally, when I set up a still life, and I did this from an actual image setup I had in front of me.
Okay.
And I did this, drew this on tracing paper, and transferred it in reverse to the linoleum block. And I have a stash of carbon paper. And you can get other types of transfer paper.
Yes.
But what I've got is some actual typing carbon paper.
Oh.
Which I don't think they make anymore.
A finite supply of that.
Right, yes, yes. You can also do a rubbing on the back of your drawing with graphite. Graphite pencil.
Yes, yes.
And transfer the image.
I've done that, yes.
Transfer the image that way. And so you can also draw directly on the plate, but your image is going to be reversed.
Interesting way of thinking.
Right, but it is an interesting way of thinking. And then when you're also thinking about this, you're thinking about positive and negative space, how the shapes are going to work together, what you want to do with your background. The areas, this particular print has a little bit of color added to it by hand after
okay.
the linoleum block is printed. And so then, like, how to design that for adding color.
Yeah, it makes each one unique.
Right, it makes each one a little bit unique. I don't very often do multiple colors with multiple blocks.
Oh, it's hard to line them up again.
You can. It's a very precise process, and most of my work in the block prints has lots of pattern and texture in it.
I think I see that in the next sample that you have.
Yes, this is another linoleum block that I have cut.
That's a lot of detail.
Yes, a lot of detail. But some of this goes very, very quickly to cut this out. And one of the interesting things about doing printmaking like this, which is a fine art process, not like doing a digital reproduction, is that once you have your block made, you do prints in an addition. Where
okay.
this one is
6 of 50.
This is a fairly large block.
And to think in the negative when you're cutting, because you want to cut away everything that's white. That's
right.
A lot of cutting when you look at a picture that's mostly black. Yeah,
right.
that's beautiful work.
Yeah, it's an interesting process thinking like that.
So if people have more questions for you, Liz, how would they get in touch with you?
Well, at the moment, we don't have a website at the moment. We're trying to get there. But and I can give people my lizart39@yahoo.com. The next show that we're going to do is in Ashuelet River Park in Keene on Labor Day weekend. We're doing the summer finale in Londonderry on Mammoth Road at their historical area, September 19th. I'm doing a show in Walpole in the Town Hall on Columbus Day weekend. There's an art tour in Keene on the following weekend, maybe it's the 17th and 18th of October. And I don't have a map of that, but I'm sharing space with another artist who invited me to her studio at 103 School Street in Keene. And then I have a solo show coming up in February of 2016 at the Works Bakery and Cafe on Main Street in Keene. And there's several locations like that that show artists' work, and I have exhibited there in different locations.
So that's how you sell your work, mostly by exhibition.
By exhibition.
Very good.
Right, and it takes time to like get what you want to do. Where you're going.
Very good. Do you show different pieces at different shows depending on the show? The show,
and the scale of the show. I also have I'm a member of the Monadnock Area Art Association, and they have gallery space at Sid's Carpet and Snooze Room on St. James Street in Keene. And so I have worked there also.
Yeah.
All the time. But it's different because they changed the show. It's like a themed show, and the next show will be, they'll do an exhibition change in the fall sometime, and it'll be a kind of a winter theme, and then that'll go until spring. And
okay.
Yeah. So that's how I show my work. Because I like being out and actually talking to people. You know, you got it. The artist is a hermit that needs to get out of its studio.
You spend all winter in your shell, and then you come out in the summertime.
Right.
Like hibernation.
Yeah.
Liz, do you want to tell us a little bit about this? If you can hold it up, please.
Yep, I can hold that up. This is a little collage that I made in September of 1999, or actually way before that. I was contacted by American Artist Magazine, who had seen some of my linoleum block prints through another artist. And they, not really a reporter, but the columnist, his name was Christopher Willard, contacted me about looking for information because he was doing a column on block printing. So he interviewed me. We talked over the phone. I sent them slides. This was way back before digital. And they published an article based on the interview and my artwork.
Is this an example of your artwork here at the bottom?
Yeah, this is an example of one of my block prints at the bottom of the collage that I made.
So
I only had a couple copies of the magazine that they sent me, and you know, and a newsstand copy or two, and I didn't want to cut those up.
No, they belong to family members,
right.
I'm sure.
Yeah.
Very good.
So
well,
I did that little collage.
Liz, thanks for sharing that with us,
and we
appreciate all you had to say and the education on linoleum block
printing. Right.
Thank you so much.
Okay, thanks.
We're meeting with Audra Saunders. She is the Director of Artistic Development.
Yes.
And she's also doing the sponsoring of the EAST program, Emerging Student Artists. Did I get EAST? Emerging Artist Student Talent.
Talent, yes.
EAST.
Yes.
So anybody could participate in this.
Yes. We're the Nashua Area Artists Association, and I think people assume that because Nashua's in that title that it's only Nashua, but it's Nashua and surrounding towns. So pretty much, you know, any student that kind of hears about it, or, you know, within, you know, local radius, they can submit their artwork. We do this all in one day. It's, you know, submission, drop off, we hang it, we judge it, we show it, and then we award the award. So it's a very busy day.
Indeed. I did see a lot of children lined up.
When it was being dropped off.
Very proud parents accompanying them.
Yes, it gets quite insanity there for a few moments.
So we have ages 6 to 9.
This is one age group. Yep, we have 4 age groups. This is the youngest group, ages 6 to 9. We award first place, second place, third place, and 2 honorable mentions for each age group. So I don't know if you want me to go through and kind of point to the artwork, or
let's see what we have here.
So looks like first and second are kind of right above each other right here. They're actually kind of clustered, not hung that way, of course, hung randomly. And the judges this year were two participating artists at Greeley, and they go through and they do their sweep through, do the judging, and then they kind of meet and agree, and they have to agree. And then from there, I just take and I put the ribbons on. So I don't have any say in the winning, because I don't want to. It's too much stress.
Very interested in techniques for ages 6 through 9.
Right.
So what grade level would that be?
Maybe some that just completed kindergarten to going into, I think, 4th grade, right? 3rd grade, 4th grade.
Young artists.
Our youngest group, yep. And then as we moved, or the honorable mention, there's one there, honorable mention. And we don't have any material specification. They can use any artistic medium that they choose. So It's kind of nice to see that there's a huge variety this year, which
Definitely.
I'm super impressed about.
Yes.
Because I don't think when I was younger I knew all these materials existed, so it's good to see that they're getting some strong art training and exposure at a young age.
Yes, indeed.
Yep.
Indeed, we grow some more artists, the next
yes.
generation.
Yes, future artists of America is what I usually jokingly say.
keep art alive.
Yes. And then as we move down this way, we have our next age group, 10 to 12. So... starts to get a little bit more heavy with the painting as the material that they use is what it's looking like this year, especially a lot of them are acrylic paint, which is a typical, besides watercolor, material for students to start painting with. And our first place is further down here, which is actually not painting. So
this whole
there's a good
this
range.
Whole
this whole
is 10
zigzag
to 10 to 12.
Of side is 10 to 12.
They picked a lot of good challenging subject matter.
Definitely. And some are drawing from observation. Some are drawing from a photograph. Some are drawing from their imagination. Some are abstract, like our third place winner, who actually is the grandson of one of our artists, Chief Johnson.
Oh, no kidding.
Yep. And doesn't let grandpa tell him what to do, so I'm going to paint my own thing. So it was good to see that.
Well, that's a very lovely first paint place painting.
Yeah, that's...
Oops. Oh, let me come around.
We're tight for space. In your way.
So that's a pastel.
That is pastel.
And as we talked about when we visited one of the pastel artists, you can see how, because it's a chalky, that you get some kind of dust underneath. So she obviously had tape around here. And then you need to protect pastels with a pane of glass.
Part of my job with working with the emerging talent is to kind of teach the students too how you should properly frame your artwork.
Yes.
We've had, as they bring stuff in, I kind of have those discussions with them. So that should have a spacer in there. It shouldn't be touching the glass. It should have had a mat board cut around it. But a lot of them are, this is their first time ever submitting artwork. So, you know, I tell them congratulations and then I'm like, okay, this is what you should do. You know, the proper artist way, and tell the parents too, because the parents have no idea. So it's a great learning experience for them.
And they get an opportunity to walk around and talk to experienced pastel.
Definitely, definitely.
And get information and
definitely.
Educational pieces
yeah.
from them.
Definitely.
Very good. What's our next art age group?
So as we work around, the sign's right there, 13 to 15. And our first place is actually right here. And this is the first time, I've been doing this for 3 years now, that someone submitted something that's on scratch board. So it's a different technique to see. And the judges awarded it. For its technical ability, because they use a small scratching tool and they're scratching the black away, so it's not like a traditional drawing. So that's something a little bit different to see for student work.
So unlike the linoleum printing that we saw earlier today,
right.
One of the artists, where she cuts away
yep.
everything that she doesn't want to be in the image, a scratch board would be completely black.
Yes.
And then you scratch away the black and reveal the white underneath to make your image.
Yep.
So if you put a scratch in the wrong place,
you got to make it work.
Make it work.
Yep. You got to make a happy accident. Yep. Make it work.
Very good. Yep. Very humorous here. It looks like he's
a little
in
bit
deep
more,
sleep.
More illustrative. Yep. Yep. We definitely, yeah, you can see a lot of personality. This age group is where they start to kind of show a little bit more of their personality. In their artwork, like the book on the face, laying in bed. Lots of story narrative with these pieces. And being a little bit older, a lot more paint, again, because some oil paint, like our third place, that's an oil painting. So that's a new material for usually this age group to work with. It's can be challenging, the drying time and color blending, it's a whole new thing for some of these guys.
I like the honorable mention with the collage.
The collage is fantastic. Something different. The scratch and the collage. This was something that I haven't seen in the past 2 years that I've been on board.
And we're looking at a computer graphic art, something.
It looks like it, but it's actually pencil.
pencil, my goodness. Yep. What great talent on that. Nice job.
Probably a future illustrator.
And yes.
On computer, yeah, definitely.
Oh, we're looking at the Best in Show.
Yep. So
on this
whole side, these are turning due to wind, but this along that side is our oldest age group, the 16 to 18. So our Best in Show is not always in the oldest age group. It just happens to be this year. And this is a young lady that has submitted several years. She's definitely going forward with an art future.
Wonderful.
For a career choice. And she, the past couple years, has been a little discouraged about her entry. So this was, I was so glad to tell her mom that she got this, because she's been waiting for something big, so.
I like the color mixing. Again, we're talking about pastel work, a chalk pastel.
Lots of layering on this piece, and it was done quickly. It's very gestural, so, and from a live model, which is hard to do.
Oh,
so.
Very good. Wow, yep. For a 16-year-old girl, that's a great skill.
Yep, definitely.
Live work is very difficult.
It's very difficult to get the proportions.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And this is a colorful piece.
We have
here. Yep, acrylic.
Big difference, huge variety, which is fantastic. This is acrylic. We do two honorable mentions each age group, so this is one of them. Very colorful, almost like I think it helps apply the cityscape, because the colors, the lights in the city, New York City, Times Square, kind of thing. So definitely works.
And a great sense of perspective.
Good
also.
Perspective, yep, linear perspective. Yep, definitely.
Very good.
Definitely.
This is very eclectic. It looks like a lot of interest here that this person has.
Yeah, this looks, they call it acrylic paint, so it's mostly paint, but there are a little bit of
mixed media
collage lettering from newspaper, I think, and magazine in there, which is pretty cool.
And this gentleman looks like we could speak to him.
Yes. This is another artist that submits very often to our student show for a couple years. I think she has one more year that she can. She's going to be a senior.
So age 18 is the limit?
Yep.
Okay.
They had to finish their senior year. If they just graduate, they can still submit this following, the summer after graduation.
Okay.
I don't know, if you want to, this is the 13 to 15 on this corner here, but this is a nice one to kind of mention.
Okay.
It's very, we do have a good amount of multicultural submission, and it's good to see different cultural icons and, in imagery, especially for the kids too, to kind of be exposed to this. So this was a great one that came in.
It's nice to see the cultural dress.
Yes.
And the skin tone and work with the eyes is just beautiful. Very skillful for someone at 14 years old.
Yeah. And on such a small scale, it's hard to get that detail with the brush. Yeah. Lots of beauty.
And these parrots. Hello.
You missed the
This is amazing. A 16-year-old.
Yeah, this young lady, she submitted last year. She was our Best in Show last year. Always works in oil. Well, submitted last year her first art show ever to submit something, and got Best in Show, and it was an oil painting. And she uses her family as her models. So it was her sister as a dancer last year, and this year these are her three sisters at the beach. Because I questioned her on, what. How'd you get the idea? Did you use a photo? What'd you do? And so they were actually there. She did some sketching. They did she took photos, and then she's been working on the painting off and on. So fantastic ability for 16.
Yes, indeed. The wave color on that second wave coming in, you get the different colors in the ocean.
Yeah, definitely.
You can tell that's here in the north.
The water has that movement.
Yes, it does.
Over the rocks. Yeah, nice. Definitely great. And then we have our first place for this age group, 16 to 18. It's called Dad, the title, so I'm guessing that this is the student's father. When you go in close and look at the amount of technical difficulty and detail that's in this graphite drawing, the skill just can't be taught. A lot of that is natural talent, so great
knowing
skill.
Knowing the strokes, where to put the texture.
Hair is something that's very difficult very, for people to learn because they want to do dark scribbles for hair.
Yes.
And you have to draw around the strands versus draw the strands. And this person definitely has that ability.
Did the reverse. So we mm-hmm. see the shadow underneath the hair.
Which is what, yeah, like way advanced.
Very nice. Will this individual be going on to some arts class, or
I believe so. She's
eligible for scholarship.
Submitted a few times. So usually with my the students that submit that are like 17, if they're going to be a senior the following, you know, school year, starting, you know, in the fall of 2015, I've already been, you know, mentioning to them, we have a scholarship program. You should, you know, apply. It's on our website. So I've been already kind of recruiting my applicants for
Excellent.
Next year. Yeah, definitely. I send it to all the surrounding schools, guidance departments, and the art teachers, and sometimes the principals to make sure that the information gets out there. But sometimes things fall through the cracks. So I figure if I tell the students themselves, then they're more likely to pursue it. So
we briefly met with Dean and
yes.
Natalie. Natalie.
Yep.
Yesterday,
yep.
The 2015 scholarship
yes.
winners.
Yep. We had four applicants that made it to the final round that did a portfolio review, and it was very difficult to pick two out of the four. They were all strong, all, you know, driven students, all hard workers, had a good variety of work, but they, you know, we only have so much money when you're nonprofit,
yeah.
so.
Yeah.
So,
yeah, that's hard.
Yeah, definitely.
And we can't go without talking about this piece right here.
Super excited to see something like this, actually. This is the first year, well, this is my third year, and the first third year, sixth show. First time something three-dimensional like this, and I'm excited. I want this to happen. I hope that more people do this. So it did not receive any awards today. However, I am making sure that this goes on display in the mayor's office at City Hall.
Oh, wonderful.
We have a program. We take the top from this show and they get a month to exhibit, and I believe it's November. So if you go into the mayor's office in November, you will see the student like first place, second place, maybe third place, and our special three-dimensional sculpture on display.
So this is called Take Back the Earth.
Yes.
And
so what the student had told me was that they all, for in their art class, someone had donated like the mannequin
yes.
torsos, and they all got one, and they had to interpret and change it and modify it and tell some type of story. So this was her story, and it looks like metal. It's not metal. She took just those like random, like colorful foam pieces that kids do foam art with.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, and she, you know, made it look like Patrick metal, painted it, did hot glue rivets, because someone actually said, gee, is this welded? Like they really thought it was
yeah.
metal, and that was her goal. So she definitely did a great job with that.
So you can see kind of moving from an industrial world
exactly.
into Take Back the Earth
yes.
and into nature.
Back to nature. And I had said when she brought it in, I said, oh, that's steampunk, which is exactly what it is. She said, oh, I'm so glad you know what that is. That's what it is. And that was her point.
Steampunk. We'll have to
yeah.
Google that.
Yeah. Lots of people are today going to go home and Google that.
Very good. Well, is there anything you would like to tell our viewers
about our programs?
Show in your East program?
Yep. So what I would like to say is probably that we're always on the lookout for donated items. Part of the way we operate for the prizes are art supplies. So if people feel like making a donation, they can donate money or gift cards to AC Moore, Michaels, anywhere that has like craft supplies and art supplies. Or even actual items, you could bring it to our art hub on 30 Temple Street. We're always, I mean, because I do two shows a year, they can donate any time of year, and I just keep it, and I, you know, pool all my stuff, and we give great prize packages to all the ribbon winners as incentive to keep them, you know, making art, and plus it's art supplies, because they all like to do art, so they're going to use it, and we're always looking for that. And then this is one show, and then we do another show in March. So for people to kind of keep a lookout, if you have a child that's definitely, you know, ages 6 to 18, we do a show in March. So
is that the one that you present at Temple Street?
That happens right on, yep, in our building, in our, I don't want to say office, but in our art space, which is called the Art Hub on 30 Temple Street, in the Finlay building. Yep.
Oh, wonderful. Right, yep. Here in downtown Nashua.
Right downtown. Yep. Park near the library and come on in.
Yep. And again, it doesn't necessarily need to be a Nashua student.
Nope, not at all. Just surrounding area. One of our scholarship winners this year was from Londonderry. So.
Oh.
Yep.
Wonderful.
Yep. Londonderry and Nashua.
Very good. Audra, thank you for
talking
to us.
You're welcome.
And we enjoyed the tour.
Thank you.
And very excited to see art continuing because we need creativity in this world.
Yeah, definitely. Thank you.
Hi, we're here with Victoria Bankston, the creator of this steampunk 3D art piece, a creation called Take Back the Earth. And this is very deceiving. The industrial foundation of this piece does very much look like metal. And I understand you use a different material for that.
I used a foam-based material and just painted over it with a metallic color. And then I added all the little dots that kind of look like screws with the hot glue gun.
No kidding. I think somebody tried to remove a leg and take it off. I thought it was real. And then we're moving up into eco-friendly.
Absolutely. The message was kind of to portray that us humans have kind of destroyed the earth and trying to bring back, nature, and that inspired the title for the piece.
Very good. What is this, a piece she's holding in her lap?
It's originally because, we're outside. There's no electricity, obviously. So it's originally a black light, which kind of portrays more of the metal-y, steampunk aspect of the piece. So when it's on, the flowers on the arm, they glow, and so do the dots on the legs and the arm.
Oh my goodness. Oh my goodness. So it has a whole different kind
feel
and imagery. In a dark situation.
Absolutely.
Well, that's great. I see that you put some kind of a light there to illuminate that.
I kind of wanted to still get that feel of light to it.
Very good. Now, what was the inspiration of this? I understand you, everyone in class got a mannequin and...
Yeah, they were donated to us through Banana Republic, and we all got just got to go free with it. Whatever idea that we wanted to do, we could do it. And whatever we wanted to incorporate. And I kind of was, at the moment, I was really into steampunk and experiencing that. And I've always had a strong feeling about how we've kind of taken away, Earth and all of its beauty. So I kind of wanted to incorporate that message. And then I just kind of went with it. I didn't have any certain plan or direction when I started. I just kind of let it speak to me.
Well, it's a great vision. And,
oh, thank
and
you.
It definitely tells a story. Just sitting there, it tells a whole story.
Thank
to
you
itself.
So much.
Did you have difficulty putting the title in it, or was that your visionary from the beginning?
It was kind of the vision from the beginning, kind of what I wanted to portray as the message to the viewers.
And how did your family think about this? What's mom and dad think?
They all love it. My mom gets a little spooked every now and again when she walks in my room and she sees a figure sitting there, but they all love it, and they're very proud of the fact that I did something so large of scale. And
Yeah. So where is it going to reside after the mayor's office in November?
I'm not sure. I'd like to enter it in a couple more shows and see how it does and see, what... I just want to get the message across to people and, see their reaction. It's just it's such a great feeling to see people see it and just be so amazed by what they feel from it,
Very good. Do you work in other mediums as well?
I do. I've explored in every type of medium. I've done painting, sculpture, ceramics, black and white sketches, anything I can get my hands on.
Oh, great, very good. Victoria, thanks for explaining this piece to us.
Yeah, absolutely.
It was a great addition to the Greeley Park East Art Show.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. We're here visiting with Jennifer Cook, a watercolor artist. She works in large pieces as well as small detail pieces. Jennifer, could you tell me about this piece that has this glorious ribbon on it?
This is a painting I started last year. It's a watercolor, and I spent a week up in a boathouse in Maine. It's actually on the second floor of the boathouse.
Oh.
And the top floor was filled with rowboats, all made with wood and lots of dust and just great colors and textures.
Yeah.
And an awesome place to paint for a week.
It's very difficult to get darks. I see you got the darks in there to enhance and bring out the boats themselves. Mm-hmm. And it looks like you actually clean the dust off these boats too while you're working.
Yeah, the dust is the best part of the painting.
Now, part of a finished piece is the framing and the presentation. I see you have a very unusual framing on this. Is this of your design, or did you go to a frame shop?
I went to a frame shop and picked out the frame that seemed to really complement the piece the best.
That can be as hard, if not more difficult, than...
It takes a long time to find the right frame for the picture.
Choice.
And then you really don't know how it's going to look till it actually shows up
it's
on your painting.
So these big pieces, again, it looks like you do some work by the water.
Yes, some. You know, I'll usually take photographs and bring them home and then paint.
It
takes me a long time to do some of these larger pieces. Any time between 40 to 80 hours of time put into them,
so
the large
layers
ones.
Layers and layers and let them dry?
Lots of layers of paint goes into them.
And your shell collection is in this?
Some of the seashells are over on the side there, and I'm painting some shells today, too.
Oh, wonderful. Very good. We'll take a look at some of these seashells that you're working on.
Okay.
We're here in the sun, and Jennifer's going to give us a demonstration of how she does her watercolors. These, again, are her favorite shell subjects, and much smaller than the pieces that we saw inside the tent.
Mm-hmm.
How do you do such small detail? Small brushes, of course.
Small brushes and a lot of patience. And again, I layer the paints on top of each other. And this I started here at the show just because there isn't much to do as you're waiting and sitting here. So with these, pretty much I'll start with layering the paints, and I'll pick a lighter, warmer color, and typically put that on down, and then grab something a bit more girthy and thick, and just sort of let it bleed on in.
And it will flow into the
lighter
color that you laid down first.
Yep, and they just sort of let them go like that and dry, and then I'll put another layer of paint on, and until they start to get the right darkness and color that I'm looking for. And I'll throw some. This is starting to go pretty good. This is a little bit hard in the sun because it
dries fast in the sun.
Fast.
Yeah, you're
so
not
you
gonna
gotta
get that.
You gotta move a little quickly for it, and throw
and
some of that on it.
You can't paint two pieces that touch each other because
no, you have to wait for it to dry. Otherwise, it'll just bleed right into each other, and I'll have a puddle of mud.
Oh yeah.
But that's about how you sort of go on through and get started painting these pieces, but I need to stop now, wait for that to finish drying.
Okay. I see you have your little shell collection here.
Yep.
And yesterday you told us that you collect these from all over the place.
Oh yeah, you know, if we go to vacation on the shore, like these little periwinkles are from around Rye and Hampton, and some of these are from the Jersey Shore and some from the Carolina Shore when we lived on down there.
Very good.
So.
Is this your next piece over here?
The seashell here? Maybe.
I saw it was sitting on the paper. I was wondering if it was just going to melt into an image.
Maybe. It's a great shell. It's got some beautiful color into it. So it might be.
Do you live near the ocean?
No, actually we live right here in Amherst.
Oh wow, so far. Very good. What would you like people to know about your work?
That I find it really peaceful. I've only been painting for 4 years. I started at the Sauhegan High School night class with Kevin Dedali.
Oh, wow.
And it's, I hope folks enjoy it. And I find nothing that brings me more peace and joy than when I paint.
Yeah.
I think everyone should try it, and I hope it inspires someone to pick up a brush and try it.
Excellent, very good. If people wanted to see your work, would they have do you have a website?
No, not yet, but hopefully soon.
Are you just starting to do shows?
This is my first show.
Your first show, well, congratulations.
I wasn't sure what to expect, but it's been a great experience.
Very good, and the National Art Show here the third week mm-hmm. of August every year. Do you have any other art shows that you're planning on doing this season?
Not yet, but the Art Association is a great group. I mean, I just joined the association this summer, and I hope to learn more about how to get more involved in the area by that.
Oh, wonderful, wonderful. Well, thank you for letting us join you and showing us your technique. Really appreciate that, Jennifer. Thanks for it.
Thank you. Thank you for talking with me.
Thank you.
Yeah.
We're here with Barry Johnson. Barry, can you tell me? Oh, Barry, can you tell me about your work here? You do watercolor and acrylic.
Watercolor and acrylics. I do some oils also, but the watercolors are my favorite right now.
Really? Yeah. This watercolor is very vibrant with the reds.
Well, this is actually this is an acrylic. I happened to have a red shirt on the day I took that picture that I painted from, so that's where the color comes from.
Very good. In the second place among all these artists? You must
In the acrylic category, yes.
Yeah, very good. Very
pleased.
Good. You told me that you and your wife travel on road trips, and mm-hmm. that's where you get a lot of your inspiration.
Yes. I like landscapes. I do old trucks that I find, you know, out in the roads or in the fields. I enjoy doing those also. So I'm having a good time. Yeah.
You've done these art shows before?
No, this is my first.
A first time?
Yeah, I retired from teaching last year, so I could get back to my painting that I wanted to do for 30 years.
To find your passion. Mm-hmm. Wow. But while you were teaching, were you also doing painting?
Very little. Very little.
Because the skill level that you have here doesn't look like you took any time off.
Well, I took courses in the early 70s, believe it or not, and really didn't paint. I raised a family. And didn't have a lot of time to paint, so now I do, and I'm really enjoying it.
And you get your muse from driving around.
Driving around.
In your Miata.
A little Miata.
A Miata. Yeah. Yeah. Very good. Do you travel, I think you said Canada?
Yeah, we did a trans-Canadian trip a couple of years ago, and then last summer we did the Gaspé Peninsula, and did that whole thing that goes along the St. Lawrence River. So a lot of these photos right there were from that area. And I'm trying to think, there was the mountains are actually from the West Coast trip we did.
So you take photographs and then take them back to your studio.
Right.
In the back of the Miata, you don't work out of the
No,
studio.
I have a three-bedroom home with one of the bedrooms is at my studio.
Oh, very good, a dedicated space, wonderful. Yeah. Very good. How would people reach you?
I have my I give them the email, I have a business card.
Okay.
I have I'm on a FASO website. My work is there. Right now it's word of mouth, and this is actually getting started, my name out there.
Very mm-hmm. good. So soon a website, you continue getting prizes at your show.
I would
your
hope
first
so.
Show, you get a prize. That's great.
I hope so.
Very good. Tell us about this truck over here and these cars.
Well, this truck here was sitting in a field out in front of a house, actually, somewhere in Maine. I think it was near Porpoise Harbor. And it looked like it had just come out of a showroom.
It does.
And it was sitting out in the snow. So it's a difficult for a watercolor for me to do something that looks shiny. I haven't learned that technique yet, so I'm still working on that. But the old cars and old trucks with the rust on them, I enjoy probably more than the shiny ones. A little bit more character to the older vehicles. That was a Gaspé trip. That farm was sitting on the river. The river's right behind that one. And I like the openness of that particular view. And this house is up in Sharon on Route 123, this farmhouse.
A lot of angles and shadows.
It was a perfect sunny day, late spring this year. Late winter, I should say. This year.
Do you find it hard to make the shadows in the white and add color to white in order with the watercolor?
Yeah, it's a little reversed from working with oils or acrylics where you can apply your white on top.
Yeah.
This you have to plan what you want to be the white, sort of work around it. So it's a little different. You have just more planning ahead of time.
Why don't you tell us your website address?
Oh, my website is B.E. Jordan. FineArtsOnline.com, and then my email is bejordan5350@comcast.net.
So if people wanted to commission a piece
they could email me at that.
Purchase one of these.
And I'm affiliated with the Nashua Area Art Association and the Lowell Art Association also.
Oh, wonderful. Very good. Very good. Thanks for letting us join you, Barry. Hi, we're in the booth of Ken Harvey, photographer in the local area.
Yes, Merrimack.
In the Merrimack area. And Ken was awarded Best in Show for his photograph here in Quebec, did you say?
This is Rocher Percé in Quebec, which means pierced rock. It's off of the eastern coast of the Gaspé Peninsula. And this was last June. And this island out here is called Bonaventure, and there are 100,000 nesting gannets there. It's wonderful to go see.
I can't imagine what a gannet is.
A gannet is a big diving bird, looks like a booby, if you're familiar with a blue-footed booby. And they're about the size of a goose.
Wow.
And they're all nesting there, making a lot of noise.
A lot of noise.
So it was a great place to visit. We really enjoyed it.
And do you wait for the sun to just hit the rocks at the right place?
I do. Usually the best time is what they call the golden hour, the first part of dawn and the last part of the day, because the light is more dramatic.
Uh-huh.
This is more of a midday, because it just happened to be we were there at midday, but I did take a lot of photographs of this, and this is the one I like best with the composition the way it is and with the clouds the way they are.
The curve in the clouds definitely echoes the motorcycle out front.
Right. Yes, okay.
And the waves, the shoreline.
Mm-hmm.
I like the way that you captured that, the curve in there.
Thank you.
Very good. You did these sheep, these animals
yes.
as well?
This one has been very popular and very successful. It won an international award, a national award, and it has been in the Fitchburg Art Museum.
What?
And Equus, my horse, has been in the Fitchburg Art Museum also. So very happy with all of these, quite frankly.
And where do you find these farm animals?
Yes, well, these sheep were at the Topsfield Fair.
Okay.
A few years ago.
Great opportunity.
And the horse is one of the horses for the Royal Equestrian School in Jerez, Spain.
Oh, wow.
And this was before the performance. The horse was waiting for its saddle.
Very patiently, it looks like.
Very
good. So these pictures that you have, these photographs from a lot of different areas
around
the world. So you travel?
I do travel. I love to travel. Some people think my job is traveling to take photographs, but it's really I'm going on vacation, and I take my camera with me.
I see. So very nice.
I'm never without my camera, because you never know what's going to pop up.
Yeah, every opportunity. Very good. This is a very unique one where you have black and white, and you introduce La Rouge.
Oui, La Rouge, Moulin Rouge. Rouge, of course, means red.
Yes.
So I changed everything to black and white. Except the parts that were red.
For the Moulin Rouge.
Yes.
Perfect. Very good. Very inspirational.
Thank you.
Now, you have cards of all of these.
Yes, I do. And, of course, I can make prints in any size that people like. I can't bring everything with me, of course. It would be impossible. But I do greeting cards, smaller pieces and larger pieces.
And if somebody wanted to get in touch with you and purchase your work?
www.kenharveyphotography.com.
Very good.
So I have my list of coming events and also some news, like I just put on last night that I got Best in Show. And you can see all of my work in different galleries.
Oh, very good. Are you doing more shows this year?
Yes, I am. I'm doing a show in Keene, Labor Day weekend, probably Londonderry in the middle of September, and then the Hollis Art Society show in November. That'll be an indoor show, so no worry about it being cold.
Is that the one at the park there?
No, it'll
the
be in the middle school.
In the middle school.
We used to have it in Lawrence Barn, but we outgrew that venue.
Yeah.
So now we're going to be at the school.
Very good. Good. So, good for you.
Thank you very much.
So you sell online and at art shows?
Well, mostly art shows. People would have to contact me about buying something. I don't have it set up where there's a market where you can put something in your shopping cart. Uh-huh. And order that way. But just look at what's there and give me a call or an email.
Very good.
Okay.
Ken, thanks. And congratulations.
Great.
And Best in Show. That's
thanks,
Jay. With all the art we've seen and the talent here, that really speaks to your credentials, your qualifications, and your
Thank
skills.
You. Well, it's a passion of mine. I love the work. I can't draw. so I have to use a camera. But as you might know, there's a lot that goes on after you take the photograph. Ansel Adams said the negative is the score and the print is the performance. So between pressing that button and actually coming up with a final photograph, there's a lot of work that goes on. A lot of people don't realize that.
No, they don't realize that. And thanks for sharing.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. We're here in the booth of Jayson Gleneck. He's the Vice President of Nashua Area Artists Association.
Yes, thank you.
And organizer, co-manager of putting this whole show together.
Yep, the Greeley Park Art Show.
The Greeley Park Art Show, the 62nd, I understand.
I think that is correct.
63 artists.
Yes, about that, yes.
So how is it to organize? Artists aren't known for being organized, so how do you get them to all
that,
work
that is
together?
True. The secret weapon is a spreadsheet. It's a very large spreadsheet, and the other secret weapon is doing it 6 months in advance. So we're planning the 6 months in advance, little things from our tents. The NA has multiple tents. So even the little things from the storing of them, you know, we're going through them, making sure that the tops match the bottoms. And so this process is going on for 6 months or more. And so that's how we start with the little things, the little problems, and then we work up to the bigger problems. And so that's basically how we do it.
Well, I see you had a lot of participation in both the adult art competition and a lot of students also this year.
Right. It is a big draw for us here. I'm not sure if every organization does the same thing. I know they usually have an adult competition because every one of the artists usually has their own booth. But a lot of other art associations don't necessarily have the student factor. They may have student work and stuff, but I don't know if they have a full student competition. And you know, we have the age groups like 6 to 9, you know, 10 to 12, like 13 to 15, and 16 to 17. So that's a lot of awards and a lot of different categories. So each category, they win a first, second, and third place prize. And then we give honorable mentions to ones that we think merit that work. And then also there's a best in show for them as well.
We saw a lot of great work for both the professional artists as well as the students.
Yeah, I'm actually more impressed by the students because they're so young and it's very inspiring. You look at the stuff and you think, I can't even do that. You know, you're very impressed that they're so focused at this young age, and I can't wait to see them when they're our age and having their own booth and they're adults and they can, you know, they can get to have their own 10x10 tent.
And the Nashua Area Artists Association sponsors a scholarship for 2 students every year, too?
Right, that is correct. There has been some corrections in the last few years. So currently, what we do is we have 2 $500 scholarships. And this year, Polly Ross, unfortunately, she passed away this year, so we dedicated 1 scholarship to her, and her family gave money for 1 of the scholarships. So the second scholarship is the NAA scholarship, and that's always been there all the time. And so that's dedicated, obviously, to the NAA, but we give the same $500 scholarship.
Oh, that's wonderful. Yeah. It really helps. We talked to the 2 scholarship recipients from 2015. Mm-hmm. Very nice, and they're really enthused about work, artwork.
Yeah, they were wonderful. I did get to see them while they were doing the judging stuff originally to get the scholarships. I think there might have been 4 or 5 applicants. There might have been more. I don't know. You know, we try to get, you know, not just Nashua, but Manchester, Londonderry, you know, it's the Nashua area. So I think, you know, it's even possible maybe somebody from Massachusetts, if they're, you know, close enough that,
sure,
you know, they apply. And if they're dedicated enough. And I did see 1 gentleman, Dean, I think is one of the winners, and he was just so amazing when I saw his stuff, when I saw him come in. Now, I'm not saying there's anything wrong with the other one, but just Dean kind of really sparked where he had fabric sewing and incorporated 2D and 3D. I mean, it just kind of blew me away. I knew immediately that this should be one of our recipients.
Well, you like to see that creativity and
right.
He
already has a plan. He already has a website with Etsy. He's already selling stuff. He already is planning to go to like business school after, you know, he's going to art school. And then I was like, this kid is, he's on the ball, and this is what we want to see. We want to see a young man come in and be this energetic and focused and, you know, and be a productive citizen. with that, yeah.
Oh, that's great, because we want to see the next generation pick up art and not lose creativity in today's technology.
Yeah, I think with this young man, that's definitely, I definitely like him, and I think he's definitely going to do all of that.
Jay, I'd like to talk about your own work for a few minutes. You're a photographer.
I'm a photographer and digital artist, and what that means is, obviously everyone knows what photography is, but basically digital art is, let's just say if you take a photograph and you start manipulating it so much that it kind of changes the originality. The best way I can explain to you is the neon art. Okay, here we go. So this is an example of a piece of digital art. So we had this model, so we scanned, you know, the photograph was taken, and so then we scanned it into the computer, and then I started manipulating it in Photoshop. So I manipulated beyond the point of a regular photograph. So obviously now this is considered digital art. So on these, let's just say you might like lighten or darken just slightly, or you know, maybe boost the hue or saturation, but you're not going this far, you know. So I still consider these photographs like original and true, and then this to be digital art. So I'm gonna put this back here. So I just wanted to show you, so this is the most newest artwork that I have, is the cherry blossoms in Washington, D.C. I was fortunate enough to be there in April, and this is the first year I was able to get the blossoms in full bloom. So you can see here it's very beautiful, pink blossoms, and so they have both pink and white blossoms, you know, around the area. And so I just have to tell you, so some of my failures turned out to be pretty spectacular.
Oh, I think so.
So this was the 100th anniversary of the Cherry Blossom Festival, and you can see this is the U.S. Botanical Garden right next to the Capitol building. And for this year, they added this red Shinto gate, so it's very gorgeous, and I got these bright orange tulips. So I just didn't necessarily get cherry blossoms, what was my intention. However, I got tulips, and I'm very happy with that.
Yes.
So sometimes it happens and sometimes it doesn't. So, but I got fortunate this year. I got lucky and I was able to get these gorgeous pictures. And there is a few here too. There's a few of these new ones. These three here are from Washington, D.C. And the interesting thing was, the first day I started photographing, it started to get later at night, about 7 or 8 p.m. And most cameras cannot autofocus for that and automatically. But this is a Nikon D200 camera, which is spectacular. It gives you spectacular results. Of course, you have to be a talented artist in order to get it to give you those results. But I think they pretty much speak for themselves, because I don't think you could do that with the regular camera at that dark at night.
And get that reflection in the water,
right,
too.
It is gorgeous. I mean, this is a perfect, like, mirror reflection. It's very good. And here's one of the Washington Monument. And some of my comments are like, it kind of looks like cotton candy or popcorn. That might be some of the names. This one I named Pink Cotton Candy. That's what that one's called. And so the names are creative. My wife wants me to use more creative names instead of Untitled 1, Untitled 2, and Untitled 3. So the title of this one is Orangelicious. So there you go. So that's pretty extreme, you know, that one. And I call this one Fluttering Sakura Petals. And Sakura is the Japanese word for cherry blossoms. So we kind of been trying to incorporate these better names than Untitled 1 and Untitled 2. So I think I have like a London Calling and the Streets of London and like Ye Old Lamppost and Raw Beauty for this Bermuda picture. So, you know, every time I travel, obviously I have my camera with me and I get some pretty spectacular pictures. One thing you'll notice is I try to have no people in my photographs. Sometimes it's almost impossible, but like London, it was pretty much impossible for me to get no people in. So I said, okay, fine. If there's people in, I'm going to use them. So I stripped the color out of the photograph, and I just left two people, their coats red and green. So I used I used the negative to my advantage this time.
What a great idea. You know, part of that creativity, not only taking the photograph, but interpreting the story also.
Exactly. These two women are walking down the street an average day, and that's why I call it like the streets of London. This is what happens every single day. They might be going to work. They might be tourists. We don't know, but like you said, we're each interpreting our own way, you know, and so I think that's beautiful with the beautiful silver frame. I just like black, so most of my frames are black, but it seemed appropriate to have a silver frame for that particular one, black and white and a little bit colorized and stuff. Yeah. Nice. So every experience is a learning experience.
Very true.
So if you don't get exactly what you want, you know, you prepare for the next time. And a lot of things happen by accident. Like I can show you this. This is a winter scene on the Kangamegas Highway. And so what happened was it was a fresh snowfall and obviously ice. So we were driving up the Kangamegas Highway and this is actually a rest stop. This is actually not even the road. And the funny thing is you pull into this rest stop and there's an overlook on the other side. And I wasn't interested in that. I didn't want anything to do with that. I was looking back towards the road. I saw these trees with ice just falling over. I thought that was just gorgeous.
Yeah, beautiful.
And so some things happen, a happy accident. You're at the right time, at the right place.
Yes.
And like I said, sometimes you wait for certain things to happen. Let me show you this one. This one, I just happened to be in New York City and it was winter time. And we're actually going to Bryant Park in the back, which they have their own Christmas tree. And so this is the New York Public Library. In the front, we have this gorgeous picture of a lion, and they happen to have a wreath and Christmas decorations. So I thought that was wonderful. It was not expected, and it just turned out great. So
make a great Christmas card.
Yes, we have a few. And one of the interesting things is I did shoot a picture of this Greeley Park with snow and the Christmas tree lit. And actually last year I got commissioned to do a much larger version on the canvas. Like this is a canvas print. So I print right directly onto the canvas at 24 inches wide and I wrap it myself on this and staple it. And then that's how you get it to be finished looking. And so it looks like an oil painting or something, but it's a different technique, obviously, because one, you're taking a photograph and then you're wrapping. With the oil painting, first you do is you stretch the canvas onto the wooden frame, and then you start, then you have to coat it with a white gesso or something, and that starts to tighten it. That tightens the frame. And then when you paint the oil paint, and it dries, it tightens some more. So it gets very tight. So these will never get tighter, but there is a little trick to tighten these in the back. But in general, an oil painting automatically gets tighter, you know?
Yeah.
These will not, but there is little wooden pegs that you put in and it stretches them. So that's it for that one.
Very good. Jay, if somebody wanted to get in touch with you about your work and maybe place an order, do you have an online presence or do they email
you? I do have a basic online presence. I think the best way to email me is the Jayson Gleneck, so I can give you my email, JayGlenneck at juno.com. That's JUNO.com. And I do have a website. It is theglenneck.net/Jayson. I just need to update it. As a web designer, you always do yours last, you know?
So we want to thank Jay, and that's a wrap.
Okay. Thank you.
All right, we're here in the booth of Carla
Sullivan.
A found art artist extraordinaire, and a welder. So can you tell me something about how you do your artwork?
Yeah.
Where you find your material, your inspiration?
I have a hunter, my mom.
Her mom scouts up all your tools.
Yeah, she brings me home all these cool things, and I just like get in there and I look at my big pile, and I just look at things differently than most people. So this is my self-portrait.
So
love and life ever since I got my welder.
Oh,
this is me.
Love and life. Very good.
Yeah.
I see time is important too.
Yes, yeah. I have things like that plane is called two saws and a drill equals plane.
Do you want to move closer to that?
No.
Show us some of these.
These two saws. Two saws and a drill equals plane. That's the name of that.
I see the pilot in there.
And I take rusty tools, grind them down, and then weld them and put them back. Sometimes I spray them down so that they won't re-rust.
And so then, some of these go outside in different places, garden?
Yep, sometimes I let them rust because I like the rustier the better. So I repurpose things or maybe you could call me a hoarder too.
And where do you get your inspiration for these? These little trio of musicians right here?
Yeah, I just go in. It's my peace of mind. It's like therapy, actually. I go in my shed in my pajamas sometimes and just don't come out till nighttime and just create, don't answer my phone or nothing.
Did you get into welding?
I started with stained glass, something like this, and it started making me sick. So then I went and bought a welder and took lessons because I wanted to start working with bigger metal pieces. I guess that's it, yeah.
What's the biggest piece you've ever made?
I have a 6-foot garden. It's made with an old wringer washer machine thing, and he's got this big fork head. It was made for Glorious Possibilities on Main Street. I have a booth down there and upstairs, and she wanted a piece for a garden, and it's made with 2 pitchforks, and he rotates, and holds a planter, and it's got a big shovel for the head with a big, yeah. I think that's probably the biggest one I've made so far. I have to be careful because this stuff weighs a lot.
Do you sketch them out before you start welding?
Or no.
You just look for the next piece?
Yeah, just free. And
So do you have students or offer workshops?
No, not yet. No. It's kind of dangerous, the sparks flying in the welder. I was taking this girl to help me grind down, because it takes a lot of grinding, because you can't weld to rusty stuff. So. But I was so worried that she'd cut, I've almost cut my finger off with the grinder and stuff. So she's not old enough yet, but eventually maybe I'll have somebody else come in and help me grind the stuff down so I can just create and make the statues and sculptures. And I do a lot of custom pieces. Most of my work is custom signs and sculptures for people that go on my website and ask for certain things. Okay. Like I had a certain person ask for a skier. So I started making a couple skiers, motorcycle people. If they have an idea, I'll make it, and if they like it, they can buy it. If they don't buy it, it's okay.
So do you show your work? It's got to be tough to carry all this.
Yeah, it is. I do a lot of local shows. I have stuff in the City Room, Glorious Possibilities. I have stuff up in the Lakes region. I'm going to be doing a show in Meredith in 2 weeks, the Sandwich Fair. For the most part, though, it's just I have my home stores on Main Street in Nashua, old Chandler building, the library.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, upstairs, so.
Very good. How do you travel with all of this?
Difficult. Very heavy. One of my other passions is I love old boxes, and I take carpenter tube boxes and put legs, put a drain, insulate them, and make ice chest out of them. Ice chest out of them, yeah. If you've seen my shed, which I think you're going to, because you're going to come watch me, I guess, right?
Yes.
You'll see. I'm like a hoarder of boxes. I've got a lot of boxes. And a lot of rusty tools everywhere, so.
So are we soliciting, should people send you their old wrenches?
That would be great. Yep, plumber's wrenches. Always looking for C-clamps. The old nail pullers. I buy stuff. If you have our home essence stuff, I'll go over and, we're like hunters.
Oh, go through the old barns, the flea market.
And my sister and my mother and I, we hunt all the estate sales and junk shops And if it looks like it, if a tool looks like it can, a letter, then I usually buy it. Uh-huh. I'm always looking for lots of L's. I use car parts. Mostly rusty tools, old silverware, anything that we can repurpose. And
so you don't see something as antique and that I can't use this because it's precious.
Right.
It's like, oh my God, I can use this.
I probably have $1 million worth of old vintage, like, hacksaws and Indian, like, way back, that probably worth more than my artwork that I've picked up. And I just, I figure I'm, like, giving it new life.
Everything.
You know?
Yeah.
So instead of throwing in, everybody's subconscious about repurposing and recycling, and that's what I'm trying to do. I'm putting my part in.
Very good. Very creative. How would people get in touch with you?
On my website, newbeginningsbycarla.com.
And that's
C-A-R-L-A, newbeginningsbycarla.com. I'm also on Facebook, or csully05 at comcast.net if they want something specially made.
Something special?
They can contact me.
Very good, good. And I look forward to seeing you in your studio.
Oh,
thank you. Welding mask.
Yeah, one of my favorite things I do is take, like, father's or grandpa's tools that passed away and make signs for people.
Oh, that's
nice. So that they have things from their grandfather, you know, make up their name in it and things like that. So, but yeah, I'd love to have you, and
when
the weather's cooler down, put your mask on you and you'll be all set.
Thanks, Carla. Okay. I really appreciate you talking to us.
Okay, thank you.
A special thank you to our guests, the artists, for allowing us into their creative space. And thank you for joining us in my studio. Please tune in again as we continue to visit the working studios of our talented neighbors.
The preceding program was provided by an independent producer solely responsible for its content. The opinions expressed do not necessarily represent the views of this station, its staff, board of directors, or underwriters.